Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, I thank you for this beautiful day, and I thank you for that breeze that's coming in off the ocean this morning. And Lord, I just pray that that's the Holy Spirit coming into our midst right now. Pray that you'd use Pastor Izzy as a vessel to teach us, to show us the truth in your word. We ask you to bless us now and encourage us. In Jesus' name we pray. Everyone that agreed said, amen.
Amen. Well, guys, if you turn now to Romans chapter 3, just a smidge up, I can... We're going to be beginning today's study in verse 21, chapter 3 of Romans, verse 21. We saw last week, we ended at verse 20 with what Paul is building this argument that, you know, what's the law for? And the law is, we saw in Galatians chapter 3, that the law is a tutor to teach us something we need. And that tutor is doing the job of leading us to who? Does anyone know what it was? To Jesus. Yeah. The law, it says through the law only comes one thing. Whenever you are presented, did any of you grow up learning the Ten Commandments in school or in catechism or any? When you read the Ten Commandments, did any of you break any? Don't raise your hand. I'm not asking confession time. Just saying, in your mind, think about, did you ever make it through all 10 without breaking at least one? You did? It says, thou shalt not lie. And that's for sure she just broke one right there. So I don't think so. There's. You know, in the design of the law, what some people don't understand is that those rules were given not that they would be the measure we would live by, but that they would become a schoolmaster, a tutor to us, that they would teach us this one thing we need to become acutely aware of so we can become right with God. And that one thing is it teaches us that we all have sin. There's not one of us can make it unscathed through the whole list. We're going to find one point or another that we've blown it in. And the Bible says that if you're guilty of breaking the law in just one part of it, you're guilty of breaking the whole thing. It's a unit. So it's not like, well, but I only broke one of, you know, when I was younger, we were like, but lying, if it's a white lie, that's just a little bit. Listen, a little bit of breaking the law, still guilty. It's still pointing out a fact that sometimes we get confused in our cultures. Why were these rules given? And they were given to show us that we have sin. Now, for most of us, that's never an issue. You know, when people come to me and talk to me about their lives, I never have too many folks going, well, I don't have sin. You know, it's not a problem in my life. You know, it's how much and how often. And it's not a question of do they do it. Of course they do it. It's like, how do I stop doing it? And that's the real frustration. How do we come to that place where we can get free from doing it? Because you guys, I'm sure you've experienced this, but whenever we sin, the Bible says the wages of sin is what? Death. And if you sin, you know, let's say, well, but it was just a white lie. Let me ask you, how many budding relationships have you seen blown apart? You know, young couples in their dating courtship, you know, period, and the guy tells a little white lie, you know, about his former girlfriend. And the girl that he's with now is like, you said that you didn't do that, or you did do that. Wait, what? And all of a sudden, I can't trust you. Because she finds out the truth, and he was telling a lie. And now, if they can't trust each other, what happens to the relationship? I mean, it was going good. But see, the wages of sin, even a little sin, the Bible says a little, Jesus taught this, a little bit of leaven leavens the whole lump. A little bit of mistrust, and all of a sudden, I don't know if I want to be with you. Have you ever heard those lines? You know, it was looking good, but, you know, I'm not sure I really can trust you. And that little lie brings death to a relationship. Now, some of us recognize it. We're like, man, why did I even go down that trail? You know, why couldn't I just make this tongue not do that. And the Bible says that James talks about this. He says the tongue is a powerful little thing. I mean, small little part of our member of our body, but it steers the whole course. Just like a rudder is a small part of a ship, but it steers the ship on its course. So this little thing in our mouth can steer the whole course of our life by some of the stuff that comes out of this. And we have to be careful. So Paul is trying to explain, when we read the law, all of a sudden we come to know, man, I've got sin. I've broken the law. Some of us have broken it in many more points than others, but nonetheless, just one infraction makes you guilty, according to the Bible's rules, of the whole thing. And so the Bible is doing this to teach us something. And that's the part we're coming to today. Paul is building an argument to help us come into a right relationship with God. And the way we come into that relationship with God is not on a basis of us fulfilling the law, of us being perfect, or us doing good works, as we're going to see today. Because Paul goes on to explain, now through the law comes the knowledge of sin. And so in verse 21, but now apart from the law, it says the righteousness of God has been manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all those who believe. For he says there is no distinction. Now remember, he's writing to the church at Rome, and they had mostly what we would call non-Jewish believers in that church. But there were Jewish believers, completed Jews, they're called. When a Jew accepts Christ as their Messiah, then they're called in the Jewish culture a completed Jew. There are also today, some of them are hated by the Orthodox Jews who don't acknowledge Christ as their Messiah. They're like, nope, he ain't it. And so they'll spit on you if you're a Christian, a Christian Jew. And so here, Paul says, listen, through Christ, God's righteousness has been exhibited through Jesus to all who believe. And then he says, because there is in him, there is no distinction. God accepts all persons, Jew, Gentile alike. Doesn't matter what your nationality, what your upbringing is. To the Lord, does that matter? Does he go, well, wait a minute. Irish, American, English, wait, you're out, you know. Is that how it works with the Lord? No. And so Paul goes on and he says in verse 23, a hallmark verse for all of us, and really we should probably write this verse maybe and pin it to the front of our refrigerator or on our mirror. You know, Romans 3:23, for how many have sinned? All. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Now, I don't know about you, but this was one of the first verses I was taught from the Bible when I gave my life to Christ. That all of us had sinned. The thing is, I already knew I had. So that wasn't even in, like, I wasn't going, not me. I was like, yep, that's right. That wasn't my problem, knowing that I had sinned. My problem was, what do I do about it? How do I deal with it? How do I fix this problem? But see, if you won't acknowledge that you have sin, it's impossible to help you get out of sin. It's like the alcoholic who says, I don't have a problem drinking, as they're just blasted, you know. Have any of you ever been around an alcoholic who says, this isn't a problem. I don't have a problem. I'm only saying this because I grew up with a whole, side of my family that were all just blatant alcoholics and drug dealers and users. And the problem with that is that some of them, when they're in that particular arena, they are blind to the fact of what it's doing to the people around them and how their behavior is. They just like it's put blinders on them. The Bible says sin blinds us anyway. That particular sin I just happened to see first, up in my face so much that I was like, have you ever had to talk to someone when they're drunk about God? And they just ramble all over the place and their spirit's not sober. And it's really, I kind of come to the conclusion, if you're really serious, you want to know about God, come see me when you sober up. Because they don't remember anything you tell them while they're drunk. So it's like Jesus said, don't cast pearls before swine. They trample them underfoot. Don't waste that. Just wait till they're sober and then tell them, hey, I got good news for you. God has made a way that we don't have to keep falling down in these areas of sin. But we have to start with this acknowledgement. How many of us have sinned? Well. And do you think he's saying that so that we will go, all right, let's point at everyone else and say, oh, well, look at her sin, or look at her sin, or look at his sin, or, you know, look at it. No. I think this is a very personal verse. It says, all have sinned, and guess who's included in all? You are. Me. I am. We are included in all have sinned. That means we have to wear the shoe because it fits. And if Christians would just, we went over this just last week, you know, there's a lot of hypocrisy in Christianity. And I think part of it is because we forgot to stay humble and see what the Bible says. We all have sinned. You know, this. Welcome to the Sinners Club. I want to welcome you this morning. Church on the beach. That you didn't know you were coming to the Sinners Club, right? See, because the Bible says, how many of us have sinned? Well, so, I mean, remember when Jesus was with they brought a woman and said, Master, this woman was caught in the very act of adultery. And they wanted to stone her. And Jesus stooped down in the sand and he began to write. And it said, beginning with the oldest down to the youngest, one at a time, they began excusing themselves. You know, oh, I forgot to say, he also said something before he stooped down. He said, let him who is without sin, you can cast the first stone. Because they said, Master, she has committed adultery. She's worthy to be, the law says she must be stoned to death. What do you say? And he just went, all right. Whoever's without sin, you go ahead and get the first stones, and you can cast the stones. And I just wonder, when we get to heaven, I'm asked for the replay. As he's stooped down, if he started with the oldest Rabbi Schneerson, and he went, took from the offering plate and stole, you know, told a lie to his wife. And what is he writing in the sand? Their name and their sin. All of a sudden they look down and they're like, I got to be going now. I think my wife needs me. And one at a time, it says, we don't know what he wrote. We just know that he stooped down and he wrote. And they began to leave. Somehow, something was going on there, you know. That's on my list of, you know, when we get to heaven, we're gonna have some popcorn nights with Izzy. I'd be like, Lord, could you put on the big screen, the jumbo screen, and let's just have popcorn. And can I watch, you know, like, could, and I don't think it's going to be like our TV. I think it's going to be like 3D. You're like there, you know, right in the scene. And I'm going to be able to sneak up over his shoulder in the scene and look down and see what he was writing. And watch the guys who, wait, that's your name? Yeah, that's got to be your name. You're looking a little antsy. And then the guy takes off, you know, and the whole thing, because he who's without sin can go ahead and condemn the other people and judge them. But that's what they wanted to do. They wanted to judge that woman. They want to pass judgment on her. They want to throw stones at her. And Jesus cut right to the heart of the matter. He said, you who are without sin, you get to throw the first stone. And after all of them are gone, and it's just him and the woman left, he stands up and he says something to her. He says, lady, stay right here. I'm going to go get some rocks and I'll stone you because I'm perfect, right? I'm just teasing you. That is not what he said. He said to her, where are your accusers? They said, there's no one here but you, Lord. And he says, well, I don't condemn you. See, this is how Jesus deals with our sin. She was caught in the sin. But all those other fellas wanted to judge her for her sin. And Jesus said, well, whoever has no sin, you can judge. And after they were all gone, because none of them qualified to be in the judge's chair, only one left that truly could be the judge was Christ. And he could have gone and got rocks and stoned her according to the law, but he shows us a greater law. He shows us something was written in the scriptures that says mercy triumphs over what? Over judgment. You know, he says, woman, where's your accuser? She says, none left but you. He goes, well, I don't accuse you. I don't condemn you. See, Jesus said, I didn't come to condemn the world. He came to what? To save it. He said, woman, go your way and sin no more. This is the thing that an encounter with Christ shows us, that he's there to help us get free. And the first thing that he does in, really, the first step of our freedom comes from him saying to us, I don't condemn you. I know you have sin, but see, I came to pay for that. And that's what the next verse of Romans is going to talk about. This verse here says, all of us have sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory. Now, I don't particularly do or teach a lot of Greek and Hebrew, word studies. I used to years ago. I love to look up the stuff in the original languages, because sometimes there's things in the original language that the meaning is so much deeper than the way it comes across in English. And this one is worthy of at least teaching you two words in Greek, okay? This part was written, put into our, written down for us in the Greek. And this part, what Paul is writing here is, when he says all have sinned, he's using the word kamartano. It's a marksman's term for shooting an arrow. And he says all of us have sinned, and it means when you shoot the arrow and you don't hit the mark. It literally means from Greek to miss the mark. You're aiming for the bullseye, but you don't hit it. I mean, it doesn't matter how much you miss it by. When you don't hit the bullseye, right? In the marksman's term, you miss the mark. I mean, and this is how he says all of us are when it comes to spiritual things. Now, if we really apply that as believers, other people come around us and we're like, look, we've all blown it. And we're humble enough to admit that we've all missed the mark. The other part, the other word here, that and fall short is a different word in the Greek, hustereo, and it means to fall. It says here fall short of the glory of God. It's a term. Paul is really, he used a lot of what I call things that they would understand. The Greeks were real into athletic games and competitions and stuff. This one, the first one is from the shooting of the arrow at the bullseye. The second one is from the running of a race. And it was a word that in Greek they used if you're a runner and you're in the lead pack, and the lead pack starts to do that last, pull away, we call it, at the end of the race, where they just, hammer down that last little burst because you're getting closer. And you don't have it in you to go away with the lead pack. And you can see them pull. If you've ever run and you've been in a race and you're putting your full might, and the people in front of you are just pulling away from you and getting ahead of you, and they're gonna win. The word for fall short is really, it's not really good translation. It's to fall back, to fall behind, like to start losing because you just couldn't, pull out that last deep dig and sprint that last thing and win the race. And so it doesn't matter how much you fall back. It's one of those kind of, and the Greeks were into the, they're the originators of the Olympic glory and all that. And they kind of, it's kind of like they only remember the first place guy. He gets the wreath. He gets the gold medal. Is it, if you fall back in your third, fourth, fifth, they don't care. It's like you weren't even in the race. I mean, you got to come in right at the, right? Don't you have to, when you run a race, you run in to win. And Paul talks about that as believers. When we run, we should run with that attitude of trying to get there to the finish. And by the way, Christ, in Hebrews, it tells us Christ is the finish line that we're running toward. He's the author, the perfecter of our faith, and he's the one we have to fix our eyes on. We have to literally fix our eyes on him and run with endurance this race set before us. But we cannot act like we're better than anyone else. We just have to be humble and go, look, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. And the next verse, verse 24, says that when we acknowledge we've all sinned, we've got a good now foundation to build upon. Spiritually, you want to have a healthy spiritual outlook, you need to acknowledge your sin. This isn't, by the way, for you to say, well, all have sinned, and let me judge all those other people. This is so that you would go, me included. By the way, if you judge others, you know, if you think this verse is so that you get the, you have a good scripture, I can just call everyone on their sin. It says right here, all have sinned. I'm here to let you all know. I'm going to tell you something. You are going to be one of the most miserable people. Because what's Jesus say? If you judge someone else, what happens to you? Remember Matthew 7? Judge not lest you be what? Judge, yeah. And it seems like people who, some people say, well, I'm not judging. I'm just, they had this term. It's not criticism. It's a constructive criticism. You know, they're doing a few things they could be doing better. So they put it under this like little cliche. This is constructive criticism for you. I'm just judging you, but I got a different title for it. And you know, the people, sometimes I notice some of those constructive criticizers are some of the most, they have no joy. Their joy goes in the toilet. And they don't even realize it. They get kind of cranky. And nothing is fun anymore. Life's not fun. Whenever we don't take this verse and turn it toward us, that we have all sinned, and that means deal with our sin personally, and we think it's about dealing with someone else's sin, then we're going to start to try to wear God's hat. And Jesus already made it clear to me, I'm not qualified to be the judge. Only he is. And so he's the only one without sin that can do the job. And he does it a lot different than I would. Because I don't know about you, but some of you, you've had people sin against you, and you would like to take care of their judgment. Not vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, but vengeance is mine, saith Izzy. Let me handle them, Lord. And the Lord goes, nope. You let me do it. See, he's the only one who can do it properly. And so Paul is saying these things so that we would take it to heart for us. So we won't go around, and if you do go around and you criticize people, or you judge them, or he could do this better, or she should do that a different way, or this, what you'll find is your joy will go down. You might not even recognize it, but your joy will start to start to feel unhappy in life. It is a direct result of when we judge others, how much joy we have. You know, when David was in sin with Bathsheba, and then he had her husband killed, and he did the whole thing, and by the time we read the Psalm 51 that we sing, we'll be singing that a little bit later in the service when we do communion, but he said, create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit. He knew he had sinned. And take not what? Thy holy what? Spirit from me. And then he says something really interesting. I think David was one spiritually in tune guy for this. He says, restore unto me the joy of my what? My salvation. But David, you know, why are you having to ask God to give you your joy back? What robbed him of his joy? Sin. Let's be realistic. He fell into sin, and David, at least he was sensitive enough to recognize, man, that joy of my salvation that I had, it's gone. Have any of you, I'm not asking for your, like, personal, like, have any of you ever lost, no, have any of you ever known a Christian who didn't have joy? Raise your hand if you knew any of those Christians that their joy had waned a little and their joy meter was pegging down by the negative numbers instead of, you know, because David said, restore unto me the joy of my... How much joy did you have when you first were saved? When you first found out Christ died for you and accounted for you, and he said, I don't condemn you. I forgive you. Go your way. Sin no more. When you found that out, how was your joy? I don't know about you, but me, man, I was just like, oh, this is the best day of life. This is the great, I mean, to know in your heart that God doesn't condemn you for your sin. And you know you've sinned. But he says, I have enough grace and enough mercy to cover that. In fact, I'll pay for your sin. When I found that out, I don't know about you, but man, my heart inside was like, oh, this Jesus thing, this is good. You know, I mean, this is really good. And I feel really great. But unfortunately, as we go through our Christian journey in this life, there are times when some people offend us. Some people disappoint us. We might not want to say it, but it starts to affect our joy meter. And we start getting, you know, a little cranky, or we see them coming. We're like, oh, man, I was hoping I wouldn't have to see them today, you know. I mean, isn't that the worst when they've hurt you and then they come? How is it that they go down the right aisle at every store you go to? You know, and how do they find you at each store? You leave, I'm leaving this store, and you go to the next one, and there they are again. Do you think God could be trying to work on something? See, because Paul understands that it's really important we acknowledge that not one of us was able to kick that last sprint to the finish and win. There's only one that has run the race perfectly, and that was Christ. And he's the one who says, I got a gift for you. I have a gift for you. Now, the gift is said in the next verse, verse 24. Romans 3:24. What a beautiful verse. It says, being justified as a gift by his grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus, whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation in his blood through faith. Now this was to demonstrate his righteousness, because in the forbearance of God, he has passed over sins previously committed. Now, there's a lot of big Christian lingo in the two verses I just read you, but I'll break it down for you. But just catch the last line. He passed over sins previously, what? Committed. All the sins you have committed, Christ has already done what? Taken care of it. He said, look, I already paid the fine. I did it. Now, if you don't understand the verbiage here, I didn't when I first read this. This is chock full of Christianese. That's what I call it, Christian lingo. You know, they got these words, propitiation. Any of you use that in a sentence this week? You know, just talking to your friends, hey, propitiation, you know. Or justified or redemption. These are not the things really that we use too much. But I want to get the concept, especially for the new ones, that they understand. This is something really powerful. See, he says that we were justified as a gift. It was a gift. By the way, justified, for ease of remembrance, I remember my Bible school teacher back at Calvary Chapel Bible School in Twin Peaks, California, 1979, he said, justified is really easy. I'm just going to tell you, forget the Greek. It's just like this, just as if I never sinned. That's to be justified. That's only Christ can do that for you, by the way, to make you just as if, in God's sight, you appear to him as if you've never, you have sinned. He's not saying you haven't, but what Christ has done is so complete that when he presents you to God, God looks at you through the offering of his son. The blood that he shed is like a filter. And every mark on me of sin, every flaw, when God looks at me, he's got this lens of Christ between me and him. And he looks through that lens. And guess what that blood does? It covers over every little spot. So God just goes, hey, it looks perfect. See, all the blotches are covered of my black sin on my soul. Christ is blocking it. But he's not only just blocking it. He's going to make it removed. And this is where we get deeper into the understanding of what Christ did for us, because it says Christ gave us a gift by his grace. Grace is unmerited favor. You guys know that. I mean, our church is amazing grace. It means we didn't earn it. We don't deserve it. We don't have to do anything to deserve it. It's a gift. Okay, unmerited favor. You know the difference between merited and merit badges in Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts. You have to earn those things. You cannot earn salvation. It's a gift. You have to do one thing, though. If I'm giving you a gift like this, here's a gift. What do you have to do? You have to accept it, right? I mean, God's saying, I want to gift you salvation. And to so many people, have you run into people you're like trying to tell them, there's a gift God wants to give you. And they're like, what's the catch? What do I have to do? I'm like, well, there is one catch. You know what I mean? Sometimes you got to humor them. Because if you tell them there's no catch, they just can't seem to accept it. So you go, yeah, there's one catch. What's the catch? You have to accept the gift. Just like if I was going to give you this as a gift, there's one thing you have to do to have it. You got to say, okay, I'll take it. I mean, God is standing there offering salvation, forgiveness of sins to all men. But if a man says, I don't want to take that gift, does God go, let me force it on you? I mean, I know some of us, I know I would, my Sicilian upbringing, I'd be like, look, you need this and you're going to take it. I wish it worked. I mean, if I could force salvation on everyone, I would have really, you know, a lot more souls on my, you know, spiritual account. I would have shoved a whole bunch of people into the gospel. Look, you need it bad. Look, I know you and I sin together. If I was bad, you're just as bad. You need it here. And I would have made them take salvation. But it doesn't work that way, does it? I can't make anyone take the gift, but I can tell them about the gift. And one thing about the gift of salvation is that sometimes I think we do a really bad job representing what a great gift it is. You know, some Christians are so hung up in what they're going through or they're judging others so they have no joy. And they've lost that joy of their salvation. And so when you lose the joy of being saved, that great gift of salvation that you receive, how do you get anyone else to be interested in it? They're like, why do I need to be saved? You look miserable. I don't want to be miserable. That's what being a Christian is about. Forget it. I'll pass. And I can't say I blame some of the non-Christians for that. They're just being observant. The Christian should be more observant and acknowledge, like David did, man, my sin made me miserable. My sin made me feel like, God, your spirit is leaving me. I need you to give me back that. Don't take your Holy Spirit from me. And make me have a clean heart, a new steadfast spirit, Lord. You have to renew me. You have to restore me to the joy of my salvation. He needed restoration. Any of you ever could acknowledge there's been periods where restoration for your joy needed to be done? The joy of your salvation needed to be restored. You know, we need this. And it could be such a simple thing that creeps in. But see, he said, this is a gift. By his grace, God has made us just as if justified, just as if we never sinned, as a gift. It says, through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus. Now, it says, whom God displayed publicly. As a propitiation. Propitiation is a big Christianese term which means a full payment, a full reckoning. The whole amount to be paid for everything owed. It's not a, let's just forget, we'll cut the debt in half and just make one big payment and the bank will accept it. Right? No. This is a banker who says every single infraction has to be paid for. It's a judge saying, you must fill in every single thing that has been broken, every single infraction of the law must be reckoned and paid in full. And that's what Paul is telling us Christ did. He paid in full, and it was so that he could redeem us. Now, I brought my little example. Some of you guys will recognize one of these books. When I was a kid, we had these at the grocery store. This one's S&H green stamps. They had gold bond stamps, and the different grocers had their own little thing. And you had to get these little stamps here to fill in the boxes. And the kids that are in the younger generation just looking at me weird right now, but don't worry. These things were like gold. Okay, anyone can give an amen? You remember these things? We would, the grocer would give out the book and it's empty, and sometimes they'd be kind and they'd put in like, what I call like, it's kind of like bingo, a free box, you know, one one part here, you don't have to paste, and you get they'll give you the credit for that. But every one of these little boxes had to be full. And once they were, what could you do with this book? You redeemed it, right? You took this book to this place called the Redemption Center. And the Redemption Center was like the superstore of ultimate prizes that they must have gotten all the wives together and said, what would you really like of, like, if you could have any of the new, latest, greatest thing, appliance or a gizmo or, and to the guys, same thing. What tools, like, you go to the Redemption Center and drool. Because it was like, for the guys, all the stuff that, boy toys, they were all there. And for the gals, they must have just interviewed all the gals and said, now, what would you really like to have? Maybe your husband hasn't been able to afford it. But if you fill in this little booklet, because every time you shop at our store, every so many dollars, we're going to give you one of these stamps, and then you put the stamp in here. And once you cover the whole page, see, this page is missing a couple stamps. And they were really, but I remember when we went to the Redemption Center to pay, you couldn't pay with money. You had to pay with these books, and these books had to be, every single page had to be filled with the stamps. And they would check every page, and if you had, and some of the prizes, they were awesome. Really nice stuff. And you'd be like, how much? And that'll be three booklets. And you're like, oh, three books. That's a lot. It's a lot of stamps. But you couldn't go in there and buy the stuff with cash. You had to have one of these. You had to pay for that prize with a book that was filled with the stamps that what were called the redemption coupons. And it was how many books to get you, what prizes that you wanted. And these things, we just prized these things because these let us get those prizes and take them from that little store to our house. We got to bring them home. And see what this word is here. It says that Christ, he was the one who redeemed us. He was the one that paid the payment, the propitiation, the payment of every one of my sins. It'd be like a little booklet of Izzy's life. Here's Izzy's life with all his sin laid out. Every little thing I did wrong marked in the book. And Jesus goes, well, we gotta get the stamps to cover it. But see, the only stamp that could cover my sin was his blood. So he had to sit there and his blood covering every one of my, and you know what? That's what he did. He paid until every little infraction in my book was covered with his blood. And then he said, Father, I want to turn in the booklet. And what price was he going to get? Who is he paying for? Me. He's paying. He said, do you not know, when he was leaving his disciples, he said, I'm going to my Father's house. In my Father's house, there's many mansions. And I go to prepare a place for what? For you. And if I go prepare a place for you, I will come again that I might receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be what? Also, I want you to be with me. But see, I never really got it until I thought about this. When we turn this in, this is not the thing that was the valuable thing. This, once it was filled with the stamps and then given to the place, and then the prize, that's what we were after, the prize. And we take that prize and we take it home. It's home with us. And what did Christ do? He said, I paid and filled in the book for you. So guess what? Who's the prize? You are. He's going, I want you to come be with me. I want you to come home to be where I am. You may be also. And that is the most awesomest news. Because we don't sometimes think of ourselves as a prize. Some people have bad self-esteem. Maybe they've been told, you're fat or you're ugly or We have cruel people in this world. Unfortunately, I hate to say this, but even parents sometimes say cruel things. It's not good. I do. I'm trying to work on it. Raquel is helping me, my youngest one. She's fast at that. You're not supposed to say that. Or you talk to me not, Thank God I have room to work on. When it says all have sinned and I say, and I did, she goes, uh-huh. Amen. My dad, the preacher. Preach it, Dad. See, but I know one thing I found out. I'm the prize. And Christ came to this world, the redemption center, right? And he filled out the booklet for every single one of us and turned it into the judge and said, here you go. You can go ahead and look. Every box, every single one covered with his blood, stamped with Christ's blood. And that's what he did for us, every single one of us. And this is what Paul is declaring in these verses. This passage, guys, is so powerful for our faith. When we let it sink in that Christ did that for me, that he looks at me as a prize, that he would come to the redemption store and he would go, I'll pay. I'll pay in full. The law, the requirement of the law was a perfect lamb, unblemished, had to be sacrificed for the sins of the world. And that's what John the Baptist declared of, remember when he saw Jesus in public the first time? Behold, the Lamb of God who what? Takes away the sins of the world. There he is. That's the offering. That's the guy. Come, what God has promised. And so he says, this is the one whom God displayed publicly in verse 25 as a propitiation in his blood through faith. He paid for each one of us. Now this, it says, was to demonstrate God's righteousness, because in the forbearance of God, he passed over sins previous. God is so forbearing. That means so, what's another English word? Forbearing is like put up with you. Tolerant, patient, put up with. Yeah, but he has put up with us being not so perfect all this time, right? But does he condemn? No. He says he did this to show his righteousness. For the demonstration, he says, I say, of his righteousness at this present time, so that he would be be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. God had a lot of patience with man, and he did a really important work sending his son to die for us and to be publicly displayed. That's why it's such a big deal. They put him on that cross. By the way, that was not a hidden little execution. That was on top of this hill. It's in Jerusalem, called the place of the skull, Golgotha, in the Hebrew. It translates into Latin Calvary. And it's literally a hillside in Jerusalem that it has, well, a sheer face on it and a round top. And right at the top up there, that's where Christ was crucified. It overlooks the old city of Jerusalem. You'd be in the old city, you'd look over at the hill of Golgotha, and the hillside has these caves in the side of the face cut away. And in the time of the day when the sun is high, the shadows of the caves, the light comes down over these caves, and there's one here, and one here, and one here, and one here, and it looks just, you can see a skull so clear. I mean, that's why it's called the place of the skull. Golgotha, it's where Christ was crucified. Christ did not come and pay our payment in a hidden way. Right there, overlooking the old city of Jerusalem, he was crucified publicly. For what? For our sins. He said, I filled in the booklet so you could be redeemed. And that's what I came to do. Now, I'm gonna say verse 27 till next week, because he says, where then is boasting? You know, I mean, come on, what do we get to brag about, how great we are? Well, we'll see. It's a very humbling thing when you accept this truth that he paid it all for you. It kind of gives you an even keel spiritually. But personally, I wish this was, Christianity 101. Every Christian had to learn this verse in Romans first. Just to start them off in the faith, like on an even playing field. So they know how to play well together, you know. Everybody, we're starting here, you know. This is Christianity 101, basics. How many of us have sinned and fall short of the glory? All. Now that we got that down, where's boasting? next week we'll pick up right there, okay? We'll see. Where is boasting in these things? Now, this is the part what is so sweet to me is that it's our first Sunday of the month. We're going to have communion. I've asked Dave to come up and the worship team come up here. We're going to sing that song I was referring to David, what he said to the Lord, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit. And before we take of communion, we want to make sure that our heart is right with the Lord this morning and that we're ready for communion. The Bible says don't take communion lightly, without first examining yourself. So we're going to sing this song, and then I've asked Dave to do the blessing and to share a couple, what communion means to him with you. Oh, give that back. And so can I have the worship team come up here and let's stand, let's sing this song. And while we are, Daniel, would you guys, Jesse, would you guys pass out the communion for me? And maybe I could ask you two gentlemen to help them with the communion. Could you help them, Dennis? And what we'll do is let's just take a moment and make sure that we have our heart right with the Lord. If you're having struggles, this is a great time to prepare your heart for communion. And let's just sing this song as a prayer. It's on your song sheet, what is it? Number 7 from the psalm.
Create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a
the joy
of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me.
Sing that last line.
And renew a right.
Last part of verse 26 says, and the justifier of the one who has faith is in Jesus. And Jesus is the justifier of us, as we've heard. I have reflected on sacrifices. And if you read in Hebrews, Paul clearly shows us that one sacrifice takes the place of all of those in the Old Testament. They were doing them, you know, all the festivals and weekly. We don't have to do that. Yeah. It was done once for us. And Jesus has made that sacrifice. And then another thing I was thinking about was how messy those sacrifices are. I thought, wow, who cleaned up the temple? And then I was reminded, it wasn't a clean, neat deal when Jesus was sacrificed either. That was suffering. And yet he did it because he was obedient. And we, as he has said, can receive that gift. Receive that gift. And if you can remember the time, I do remember the time, I was 12 or 13 years old at a meeting, and there was whole circumstances as to how and why and didn't want to be there and so on and so forth. But I remember being so clean inside. Just, wow, this is totally different.
Amen.
And then about 15 years later, I was contemplating and wondering, Lord, I'd like to feel that again. And he blessed me. I haven't asked since, because I thought, okay, I know I'm clean. He did it. I'm done. And Jesus is the one that introduced the new covenant. Well, we say that, and actually God did it in Jeremiah. But on the night of that he was betrayed, and they were celebrating the Last Supper, and Paul quotes him. He says, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's remember Jesus and his sacrifice by sharing together.
Thank you, Lord.
And continuing on, in the same way he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. A new covenant. The old covenant, the law, is now new. The new covenant.
That's why he gave us the cup to drink next.
Right. And we do that in remembrance of him.
Jesus was smart. If you ever have to remember, just remember what happened to Dave. The bread gets stuck.
Move on.
But
quickly.
The Bible says you can do this as often as you wish, as long as you understand we're doing it in remembrance of him. And the Bible tells us whenever we partake communion, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We're just proclaiming Christ died for us. You know, and it's a great proclamation. Hey, guys, I don't know about you, but maybe some people don't know that yet. That's what he did. That was the big deal, him coming to pay and make that payment. So we can say, hey, you know, I'm not the only prize in the redemption center. Christ paid for you too. And if the gospel was presented that way, do you think it might make the other people feel special like we feel special? I mean, they would come to know his love and forgiveness. And I think it's a really beautiful thing that we kind of, sometimes we take it for granted. Some of you have been Christians so long, you've just been, I've done this so many times. No big deal. But listen, I don't know about you, but like you said, whenever you ask the Lord to give you that cleansing, does he clean you up? Oh, yeah. And we're going to sing this song to remember that and end our service. It's from Isaiah chapter 1, and it's verse 18, and it's on your song sheet. Number 9. It's called White as Snow. And if you've asked the Lord to forgive you this morning, would you join me? Let's pray together. Lord, we ask that you would forgive all of us as we're here together, that you'd forgive us our sins and make us clean as only you can. Make us white as snow, we ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said,
Amen.
Let's sing this. White as snow, white as snow, though my sins were as scarlet, Lord, I know, Lord, I know that I'm clean and forgiven through the power of your blood, through the wonders of my sin were as scarlet, Lord, I know, so Lord, I know that I'm free and forgiven through the power of your love, through the wonders of thank you that you have such great forgiveness toward us. Thank you for your payment for our sins. And we pray for anyone that doesn't know that sweet grace that you want to extend them, that today would be the day of introduction to your saving grace, Lord, that they would come to learn that you paid for them too. And for us that know that already, Lord, we say we're very grateful. Just take us from this place now clean and refreshed and filled, Lord. Fill us to overflowing with your Holy Spirit, that your grace and mercy and love would just flow out of us like living fountains of water. Your life pouring forth through us as vessels. As we go from this place, let us bring life to all those we come in contact with, Lord. We ask that. And we pray that not just for us, Lord, for all the fellowships up and down our coast, throughout our islands, Lord, that you would pour out your Spirit upon us in these days, and we would be used as a light and as life, water in a desert, Lord, to bring life. Make us that living water. We ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said,
Amen.
Amen. Now, if you ask the Lord to forgive you, I get to do what Pastor John taught me, the favorite part of my job. It's not I get to say your sin. I'm just telling you, if you asked him to forgive you, does Christ forgive you your sins?
Yes.
So your sins are forgiven. Christ forgave them. And go in that knowledge. Go starting off your week just feeling cleansed. All the stuff it's erased. You got a clean slate. You're starting off clean. Go have a great week in Christ and just keep going on. You know, you get drugged back in sin, just pray that prayer we just sang. Lord, create in me a clean heart. Make it new. You know, restore my joy and keep going on. So that's my encouragement to you this week. I pray you have a great week. Come out Tuesday night if you can for the Psalms.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.